Recorded Books and RB Digital present Foxmask by Juliet Marillier, narrated by Saskia Maarleveld. Chapter 1. Excerpt from letter reads, "If anyone can understand, it will be you. I have always respected your intellect. I had so much to offer here. I could have achieved great things, and in time all would have thanked me for it. Yes, even the Wolfskin. That he has been the one to wrench the possibility from my grasp is bitter indeed." The day Thorvald's mother gave him the letter, everything changed. Cray was weaving, hands busy on the loom, shuttle flying, a fine web of blue and crimson unfolding before her in perfect pattern, testimony to the skills Aunt Margaret had taught her. So industrious was she, and so quiet, that it seemed she'd been forgotten. The bestowal of such a perilous gift as that letter was surely best suited to a moment of complete privacy. Aunt Margaret spoke to her son quietly in the long room before the hearth. Cray could see them through the doorway from the weaving chamber. They did not argue. Voices were seldom raised in this most orderly of households. But Cray heard the front door slam open, and she saw Thorvald go down the three steps in a single stride, then vanish across the yard and out over the spring fields as if hunted by demons. She saw the bloodless, driven look on his face, and although she did not know it at the time, that was the moment Thorvald's life, and her own, took a twist and a turn and set off in an entirely different path. Cray knew Thorvald better than anyone. They had been childhood playmates, and they were fast friends. Thorvald had few friends. The fingers of one hand would be more than enough to count them. There were perhaps only two to whom he ever spoke freely, and whom he allowed close. Herself and Sam, the fisherman on whose boat Thorvald sometimes helped. As for Cray, she understood Thorvald well. His black moods, his lengthy silences, his sudden, brilliant schemes, and his rare times of openness. She loved him for all his faults. In her mind, there was no doubt that one day they would marry. He wasn't a real cousin, just as Margaret wasn't a real aunt. The tie was one of old friendship, not kinship. If Thorvald hadn't seen yet that he and Cray were destined to be together forever, he'd realize sometime. It was just a matter of waiting. The shuttle slowed to a stop. Cray stood gazing out the doorway across a landscape dotted with sheep, new lambs at foot. From Aunt Margaret's house, you could see all the way to the Western Ocean, where stark cliffs marked the margin of land and sea. Far off now, there was the small dark figure of Thorvald, running, running away. Cray had seen a terrible change in his eyes. "Finished?" Cray jumped. Margaret had come up beside her without a sound. No, but maybe I should go home. Father's due back from Sandy Island, and I should be helping." Cray fell silent. Aunt Margaret had tears in her eyes. Such a phenomenon was astounding. Her aunt was a model of propriety and restraint. She never lost control. This household, run by Margaret's longtime retainer, Ash, but ordered by Margaret herself, operated to a strict routine with little allowance for errors. This approach was reflected in Margaret's own appearance. She was a handsome woman of around 36, her hair a rich auburn, plaited neatly and pinned up under a snowy lace cap. Her linen gown was ironed to immaculate pleats, her woolen overdress fastened with twin brooches of patterned silver, polished to a moonbright shine. She bore the accoutrements of a good housewife, knife, scissors, and keys hanging from a chain. Margaret was capable. Some found her intimidating. She had never remarried after her husband died in the very first year of Norse settlement here in the Light Isles, before Thorvald was born. Cray did not find her aunt frightening, but there was a bond between them. Cray might not be skilled in the arts of a priestess, as her sister Ayanna was. She might not be beautiful in the style of the island girls, slender, dark, and graceful. But she had other abilities. Young as she was, Cray had the best hands for midwifery in Rosie. and had advanced quickly from assisting the island expert to taking a full share of responsibility. The women valued Cray's deft touch and cool head. These made her youth irrelevant. The same clever hands gave her a talent for spinning, weaving, and embroidery. Margaret valued that talent, and over the years she had taken pleasure in fostering this buxom, fair-haired niece's skills. If Thorvald never comes around to marrying me, Cray told herself sourly, some other man surely will, just so we can see his wife's the best weaver in Rossi. It wasn't as if nobody was interested. Cray was never short of partners for dancing. Sam had made her a whalebone comb with sea creatures carved on it. Eyl had composed a poem for her and recited it, blushing. Brood had kissed her behind the cowshed when nobody was looking. The problem was she didn't want sweet-natured Sam or scholarly Eyl or handsome Brood with his merry blue eyes. She only wanted Thorvald. Thorvald had eyes dark as night and smooth auburn hair like his mother's. Cray loved his cleverness, his wit, the way he could always surprise her. She loved his moments of kindness, rare as they were. She wished sometimes that he were a little less aloof. She'd heard other girls call him arrogant, and she didn't like that. He did keep himself to himself. She was lucky to be one of those he considered a friend. Cray sighed. Thorvald was taking a long time to realize she could be more than just a friend to him. At 16, she was a woman and ready to be married. More than ready, she thought sometimes. If Thorvald didn't wake up to himself soon, her father would start suggesting likely husbands for her, and what could she say then? As her mother's daughter, she must wed and bear children. It could not be long before Eyvind began to apply subtle pressure. Cray?
Oh, sorry.
She'd been daydreaming again.
Are you all right, Aunt Margaret?
Well enough. The words belied the red eyes, the tight mouth. Go on then, if Nessa's expecting you home. This can wait for tomorrow. The design's coming out well, Cray. You're quite an artist.
Cray blushed. Thank you, Aunt.
She paused.
Aunt Margaret.
Margaret raised a hand. It was a gesture that said plainly, no questions. Whatever it was that had sent Thorvald out of the house like a man pursued by dark dreams, it was not going to be shared just yet. Cray, said Margaret as her niece hovered in the doorway, small bundle of belongings in hand. Don't go after Thorvald. Not today. Believe me, he's best left alone a while.
But
if he wants to tell you, he'll tell you in his own time. Now off home with you. Your father's been away a long while. I expect he'd enjoy some of his daughter's fine cooking. Perhaps your roasted mutton and garlic, or the baked cod with leek sauce. Off with you now. The tone was light, kept carefully so, Cray thought. It was her aunt's eyes that gave her away. Thorvald's had held the same shadow. Sometimes Cray did as she was told, and sometimes she didn't. Thorvald was sitting on the ground, his back to a low stone dike overlooking the western sea. He had his head in his hands, his face concealed. His sleek red hair had escaped its neat ribbon, and the wind whipped the strands like dark fire in the air around his head. He was very still. Behind him in the walled field, sheep bleated and lambs answered. Above in the sky, birds fluted songs of spring. Cray climbed over the wall and sat down by his side, saying not a word. She had become quite good at this kind of thing.
Go away, Cray, Thorvald growled after a while.
He did not open his eyes. There was a little boat out in the swell, coming in from fishing. The wind was picking up. The scrap of sail carried the vessel forward on a fast, rocking course southward, perhaps to Hafnarfjörður, or some point closer. Cray raised a hand in greeting, but they did not see her.
I mean it, Cray, snapped Thorvald. Go home. Go back to your embroidery.
She took a deep breath and let it out, counting up to 10. It was useful to have wise women in the family. One might not learn the mysteries, for those were secret, but one did at least pick up techniques for staying calm.
What is it?
She asked him quietly.
What did she give you?
I don't want to talk about it. Not to you, not to anyone.
All right, Cray said after a moment. I understand. When you do want to, I'll be here to listen.
Thorvald balled his hands into tight fists. His eyes were open now, staring out to the west. It seemed to Cray that what he saw were not cliffs, gulls, clouds, a wind-stirred ocean, but something quite different and much farther away. Time passed. Father would be home soon. The remark about roast mutton had been true. Such simple pleasures had the power to bring a smile to Avon's lips, and a light to his eyes that warmed his whole family. It was not so much the good food that did it, as his daughter's thoughtfulness and skill. Cray rose to her feet, picking up her bundle.
Cray.
It was a dark whisper. She stood frozen in place a moment, then sat down again without a sound.
A letter, Thorvald said. From my father. She kept it all these years. She never even told me.
Cray was at odds to understand the bitterness in his tone. His father had died before he was born, and that was indeed sad, though surely sadder for Margaret than for this son who had never known the father he had lost. From what folks said, Margaret's husband Ulf had been a fine, noble chieftain who had led the first Norse expedition here to the Light Isles. He was a father to be proud of. A letter was good, wasn't it? It seemed not inappropriate that Margaret had saved it until her son was a man.
From Ulf? Cray asked gently. I suppose that is distressing. It reminds you of what you might have had. It is a sorrow he was not here to watch you grow up.
I didn't say it was from my mother's husband, the worthy Ulf Gunnarsson.
Thorvald's voice was sharp-edged.
I said it was from my father, the man she tells me was my real father, that is. Here, if you're so interested. Why not find out all about it, since it seems half the island knows already?
He drew the little roll of parchment from the breast of his tunic and thrust it into her hand. Cray was mute. What could he mean? He untied the cord that bound the letter and uncurled it to reveal row on row of neat black script. It was old, the edges worn, the characters smudged here and there as if by drops of water. There was a pale line all across the outside where the cord had fastened it, as if the small scroll had lain long untouched.
You know I can't read, Thorvald. What is all this about?
I'll tell you what it's about. It means I'm nobody. Worse than nobody. I'm the son of some evil madman, a crazed killer. Forget Ulf. Forget a conception and the respectability of marriage, and the sad demise of my father before I saw the light of day. Ulf was not my father. She kept that from me all these years, and they knew. Your father, Nessa, Grimm, everyone who came here in those first days. Even that stick of a serving man, Ash, knew the truth and kept quiet about it. A conspiracy of silence.
His voice was shaking. He stared fixedly at the ground by his feet.
How could my own mother be so cruel?
Cray was lost for words. She wanted to put an arm around him for comfort, as she would do if this was one of her sisters. But she did not. Thorvald would shake her off the instant she touched him. This news was indeed terrible, if true. What if such a thing had happened to her? Her own father was the center of her world, the warmth at the core of the family. Indeed, sometimes it seemed Eyvind was father to the whole community, guardian and loving protector to them all. To hear your father was not your father would be like the snatching away of everything safe. It would be like sundering the heart from the body. There seemed no way to comfort him.
You're very quiet, Thorvald said suddenly, turning his head to glare at her. No ready words of advice, no quick solutions to my problems.
His eyes narrowed, his mouth went tight.
But perhaps you knew this already. Perhaps I am indeed the last to be told the truth about my own heritage. Did you know, Cray?
His tone was savage. Cray shrank back before it.
Of course not. How could you think?
Thorvald's shoulders sagged.
His anger was turned inward again. That's just it. I don't know what to think anymore.
Who was he? Cray ventured. Was this letter written to you? Where is he?
Ask your father. He knows the answers. But ask Eyvind. He was the one who exiled my father from this shore, so that he never knew he had a son. The letter was to my mother. It says nothing of me. It attempts to explain to her why her lover killed her husband. It tries to justify his murder of his own brother. You see the delightful heritage my lady mother has chosen to make me aware of now I'm deemed to have reached years of maturity.
Thorvald picked up a stone and hurled it out beyond the cliff edge. A cloud of gulls rose, screaming protest. His face was sheet white, the eyes dark hollows. What was his name? Cray asked, playing for time as her mind searched frantically for the right thing to say. In such a situation, there probably was no right thing.
Somerled.
He threw another stone. Why don't they speak of such a man? They must all have known him.
Why don't you ask them if you're so interested?
She breathed slowly. Thorvald?
What?
Aunt Margaret was wise not to tell you this before. You're grown up now. Couldn't you see this, not as a reversal, but a challenge? His brows rose in scorn.
What can you mean, Cray?
You could find out about Somerled. As you said, there must be plenty of people in the islands who knew him back then. Maybe he wasn't as bad as you think. Everyone's got some good in them.
And what comes after that? Thorvald snapped. I jump in a boat and go off looking for him, I suppose.
The words hung between them as the silence stretched out, giving them a weight Thorvald had not intended. Blue eyes met black. There was recognition in both that this crazy idea was, in a way, entirely logical. Thorvald rolled the letter up and knotted the cord around it. He put it away and leaned back against the wall, arms hugging his knees, eyes firmly closed. She waited again. At length, not opening his eyes, he said,
I know you're trying to help, Cray, but I really do want to be by myself.
There was a pause.
Please,
he added. It was not possible to bestow a gesture of affection, a quick hug, a hand clasp, although Cray longed to touch him. Farewell, Thorvald, she said, and made her way home under darkening skies. She couldn't ask them straight away. This was not a topic that could be broached amidst the general joy and chaos of her father's return, with dogs and children jumping about making noise, with Nessa failing to hold back her tears, and Eyvind himself doing his best to hug everyone at once while burdened with axe, sword, and large pack of belongings. He was not a man who asked others to fetch and carry for him, not even now he bore such authority in the islands. When he had married Nessa, he had allied himself to the last royal princess of the folk. This had conferred a status above that of ordinary men, and Eyvind had built on it by dedicating himself to the establishment of a lasting peace between the two races that had once been bitter enemies, the Norse invaders and the folk who had inhabited the islands since ancient times. It was due more to Eyvind than anyone that the two now lived so amicably side by side, and indeed together. It was almost possible to forget that it had all begun in blood and terror. As for Nessa herself, she had never lost the respect due to her as both priestess and leader of her tribe, a rallying point in times of terrible trial. Now Eanna was priestess. Nessa no longer enacted the mysteries, nor withdrew to the places of ritual. She had her husband, her four healthy daughters, her household and her community, and played a part in councils and negotiations as befitted her special status. For all that, there was a sorrow in it. Eanna had been the first child for Eyvind and Nessa. The next had been a son, and the sea had taken Kinnart before he'd seen 5 years in the world. After him, there were only girls. Cray herself, then Brona and Ingeyerd. That was not as it should have been, not as the ancestors foretold it. Despite their near-royal status in the islands, Cray's family dwelt in a compound that was more farm than palace, a sprawling set of low stone buildings surrounded by walled infields, somewhat east of the tidal island known as the Whaleback. The Whaleback had once been the center of power in the Light Isles. Nessa had lived there. Her uncle had been a great king. When the Norsemen first sailed out of the east, Margaret and Nessa and Eyvind had not been much older than Cray was now. That voyage of discovery across the sea from Rogaland to the sheltered waterways of the Light Isles had begun as a search for a life of peace and prosperity. It had turned, in the space of one bloody year, into a bitter, destructive conflict that had come to an end only after most of Nessa's folk had been cruelly slain. It was Eyvind and Nessa, Norse warrior and priestess of the folk, who had won that peace, the two of them side by side. What different lives they had had, Cray thought, watching her mother and father as they stole a quiet moment together. Nessa brushed Eyvind's cheek with her fingers. He touched his lips to her hair. The way they looked at each other brought tears to Cray's eyes. Their youth had been full of adventure, journeys, battles, struggle, and achievement. Looking at them now, she could hardly imagine that. One did not see one's own parents as heroes, even if that was exactly what they were. One simply saw them as always there, an essential part of one's existence. Where would one be without that? She had to ask them, but not yet. Supper first. There were men and women who lived in the household, house carls, Eyvind called them, in the manner of his homeland. These were capable folk who seemed almost part of the family. The women had become used to Cray taking charge in the kitchen, especially when she wished to prepare a special meal for her father. Today, someone had been fishing, and there was fresh cod. Cray sent Brona out into the garden for leeks and fetched garlic and onions herself. Small Ingegerd was soon persuaded that cutting vegetables and stirring sauces and grinding herbs would be tremendous fun, and it was possible for Nessa and Eyvind to retreat to the inner room for some time alone. Cray told her sisters a story as she prepared the fish. It was a tale about the hidden tribe, those tricky spirit folk who were seen from time to time in ancient underground places. And she made sure it was long and exciting, and allowed the children to interrupt with questions as often as they liked. It grew dark. The folk of the household gathered around the table for supper. Cray's efforts were rewarded by Avon's smile and Nessa's quiet words of approval. Brona ate every scrap and carried her platter to the wash trough without being asked. Ingegerd was falling asleep even as she finished her meal. Respecting the family's need for privacy with Eyvind so newly returned, the men and women of the household did not linger after supper, but retired early to their sleeping quarters. It was night outside, and a sudden chill crept into the longhouse, though its walls of stone and earth were thick and sturdy. Eyvind put more turf on the hearth, and they moved in closer. One on either side of the flickering oil lamp, Cray and Brona worked on their embroidery. Brona was making laborious progress with a row of small red flowers across an apron hem. Cray's project was more complex and more personal. She called it the journey and worked on a small section at a time, keeping the rest folded out of sight. It was quiet now. Ingegerd drowsed on Eyvind's knee, held safe by the arm he curled around her. It was a shame, Cray thought, that the whole family could not be here together. That would happen increasingly rarely now that Ayana had completed her training as a priestess of the mysteries and retired from ordinary life to dwell in the hills alone. She must ask them tonight. This could not wait. Eyvind carried Ingegerd to her bed and tucked the covers over her. Brona pricked her finger and yelped. She sewed doggedly on for a while, then sighed, yawned, and packed her work away. Good night, Brona. Cray said a little pointedly. I'll help you with that in the morning if you like. Brona flashed a grin and turned to hug first father, then mother. She bent to light her little oil lamp with a taper from the fire, then disappeared along to the sleeping chamber she and Cray shared. More ale? Nessa queried. What about you, Cray? Don't strain your eyes with that fine work, daughter. You look tired out.
Come, sit by me, said Eyvind.
I've missed my lovely girl. Tell me what you've been doing while I was gone. I expect Aunt Margaret's been working you hard.
Cray sat. She took the cup of ale her mother offered. Her father put his arm around her shoulders, warm and safe. If the topic were to be raised, there could be no better time for it. Father, mother, I want to ask you something. They waited. It's about Thorvald.
Silence again, though there seemed a change in the quality of it, almost as if they had expected this.
Today he was very upset. It was because Aunt Margaret told him about his father, his real father.
She felt the sudden tension in Avon's arm and heard Nessa's indrawn breath.
I tried to help him. I tried to listen, but he was too angry. He said, Aunt Margaret told him his real father was a murderer. That's what he said, that he killed his own brother, Aunt Margaret's husband. And he said,
she faltered. What, Cray?
Avon's tone was calm enough. That you sent Thorvald's father away, she whispered. Banished him from the islands so that he never knew he had a son.
I see.
Father, why is it none of you told us that story? Is it true? And wasn't it cruel of Aunt Margaret not to tell Thorvald until now? He's so angry and bitter. I've never seen him like this. There was nothing I could do to help.
A look was exchanged between her parents, a complicated look. Eyvind took his arm away from Cray's shoulders and clasped her hand instead.
Did you talk to Margaret about this, Cray?
No, she told me to wait until Thorvald was ready to tell me, but...
But you couldn't wait. Nessa's tone was dry, but not unkind. Cray, this is Margaret's story and Margaret's secret. It was her choice to wait until Thorvald when she judged he was ready. Those were terrible times. To dwell on what had happened was to set a barrier between your father's people and mine that would keep us at enmity all our lives, and would be passed on to our children and our children's children. There had been enough hatred and cruelty. We made the decision in those early days to put it behind us. We didn't forget. One carries such memories in one's mind forever. But we chose to move on, all of us. I suppose now it will be discussed more widely.
Thorvald is sure to talk to his friends, you included.
Ayana knows what happened, Cray, Eyvind said quietly. One cannot follow the calling of priestess without the knowledge of history. She has kept it to herself, as we promised Margaret. That was for Thorvald's sake.
Cray said nothing. It hurt sometimes to be nobody special, even though she had no great ambitions for herself. It hurt even more that her parents hadn't trusted her to keep a secret.
I had an interesting talk with a man called Gartnett at the Thing on Sandy Island, Eyvind remarked, apparently changing the subject completely. A chieftain from the Northern Isles, a fine-looking young fellow of around 22, very well-mannered and courteous. He asked me about you, Cray. It seems talk of you has spread quite far.
Talk? What talk?
Eyvind smiled.
Nothing bad, or I'd not have spoken so fair of the fellow. You were described as a model of young womanhood, highly skilled in all the domestic arts, and far from ugly into the bargain.
Eyvind.
Nessa frowned at him.
His exact words were a good deal more complimentary than that. In fact, your virtues were enumerated at quite some length. But I won't repeat them for fear of giving you a swollen head, daughter. It was clear the young man's interest had been sparked by what he'd heard of you. He's looking for a wife.
Oh.
You'd have liked him, Cray, her father said. He was an honest, open sort of man, with a ready smile, and handsome. Did I say that? You will need to start thinking of this sometime soon. You know how important this is, not just for yourself, but for all of us, for the islands.
This is not the first such inquiry your father has had, Nessa put in. Cray stared at her mother, sudden hope making her heart race. Had Thorvald said something at last?
Cray, Eyvind said quietly. We wondered how you would feel about going away for a while, perhaps with your Aunt Margaret to chaperone you. A stay in the Northern Isles would do you good, expose you to a wider circle, allow you to mix and give you some respite from your domestic duties here. You work yourself very hard, my dear. A visit over the summer would be easy to arrange. We have friends there. I'm not pushing an alliance with this Gartnet. You'd meet many folk. It would enable you to be seen and put you in a position to get to know both him and others. You could make your own judgments then.
You know the importance of a good choice, Nessa said. If we do not nurture the bloodline, the identity of the folk is quite lost. It is your children, as well as Brona's and Ingeyerd's, who will carry forward the royal line. Cray did know. One did not grow up in such a family without an understanding of the royal descent, and the significance of marriages. Nessa had been the only surviving kin of the great Engus, last king of the folk in the Light Isles. She was his sister's child, and as the royal succession came through the female line, it was vital for her daughters to marry men with impeccable credentials, since their sons would have a claim to kingship. As Nessa herself had no surviving sons, this was doubly important. It still mattered, even though the islands were governed by council now, and no longer chose kings. You must wed wisely, Nessa added. There was a silence. I thought we were going to talk about Thorvald, Cray blurted out suddenly, finding herself on the verge of tears for no good reason.
We are talking about Thorvald, Cray, said her father gently.
She felt herself grow cold, a weight lodged in her heart. There seemed to be nothing to say. You asked for the story, said Nessa. We'll tell it, but I suggest you take Margaret's good advice and keep it to yourself. This is Thorvald's dilemma and hers. They are best left to deal with it in their own way. Thorvald's father was a man called Somerled. He was indeed Ulf's brother, and came here to the islands in that first expedition, the same that brought Eyvind to this shore.
Ulf wanted peace.
Eyvind took up the tale.
He made a treaty with King Angus, Nessa's uncle. All seemed well, but Ulf died. He was murdered under very odd circumstances. My people blamed the islanders, and war broke out. There was great ill-doing. Many died.
Nessa glanced at him, a little frown on her brow. In the soft lamplight, with her pale skin and wide grey eyes, she looked very young, not at all like a mother of four daughters. She reached out and took her husband's hand. My own people were all but wiped out, she said gravely. My uncle died, my cousin, everyone close to me save Eyvind and Rona. Nessa paused. The loss of her old mentor, the wise woman who had taught both Nessa and her daughter Eyana the mysteries of the ancestors, was still fresh, for Rona had lived long, passing peacefully with the coming of last spring. It grew clear to me and to your father that Somerled, who had become leader after Ulf's death, was responsible for the wave of fear and hatred that had gripped the islands. Your father was very brave. He confronted Somerled at risk of his own life and proved him guilty of his brother's murder. Eyvind smiled faintly, though his blue eyes were troubled.
As I recall it, it was your mother's courage that tipped the balance. Without her, all would have been lost.
I don't understand, Cray said, struggling to make sense of this. Where does Aunt Margaret fit in?
Despite what he did, Eyvind said, Somerled was not a wholly evil man. At least, I did not believe it of him, and nor did Margaret. We saw some hope for redemption in him, a spark of kindness, of goodness that might become more, given the right nurturing. There was a time when Margaret was very lonely. Ulf, fine man though he was always busy with his own projects, and I think she suffered for that. Somerled admired her greatly. Subtlety and cleverness had great appeal for him. In Margaret, he saw something he found only rarely, an equal. But in the end, theirs was not a happy alliance. She could not tolerate what he did in his quest for power.
But she bore his child, and yet you exiled him.
It seemed very cruel, even if the man had been a murderer. It seemed not at all the kind of penalty loving, generous Eyvind would impose. I was faced with a choice. Under the law he himself had instituted, I could have sentenced him to death. That was what Somerled had wanted. He had always been fiercely ambitious. For a season he had been king here. Now he was defeated. Even those who had supported his actions were deserting him. He had nobody left. He begged me to kill him. The sentence I decreed was a measure of the fact that I still had faith in him, even after the terrible havoc he had wrought. It gave him another chance to change his path, to learn to walk straight. I thought I was being merciful. To Somerled, the punishment I imposed seemed cruel beyond belief.
He left this shore without knowing Margaret carried his child, Nessa said.
Rona knew, I guessed. But Margaret did not tell him, nor did she speak of it to me until Somerled was gone.
That would have made no difference to Eyvind's decision. Somerled was not fit to remain in the islands. He treated my people with contempt.
Many thought Eyvind's decree too merciful. They feared Somerled's return. He was a man who could wield great power. He influenced people through fear, and fear is a potent weapon.
But Eyvind made him promise never to come back. He made him promise to do his best to change. Whether Somerled had kept to that, I suppose we'll never know.
Why would he promise such a thing?
Because of this, Eyvind said, rolling back his left sleeve to show the long scar that ran up his inner forearm.
Cray had always thought this a legacy of the life her father had once led as a wolfskin warrior. His body bore its share of the marks of combat.
Somerled and I were blood brothers, sworn to lifelong loyalty. He challenged me with that bond at the end, and at the end I held him to it. Then I sent him westward across the ocean. Perhaps it was, after all, a sentence of death. In all these years, we've never had any word of him.
Cray was speechless. This was like something from an old saga, the kind full of gods and monsters. It was surely not real life.
It's true, Cray, her mother said.
Those were terrible times. Eyvind and I were lucky. Our love for each other made us strong. The ancestors warned us all along that our path would be hard, yet they told us we were doing right. Some very old powers stepped in to aid us in the end, but it was human courage that won the day. You must not think harshly of your Aunt Margaret, although she lay with a man who was not her husband. She's a strong woman and proud. Her life has been lonely because of the error she made then. She has never forgiven herself for it.
She has Thorvald.
Yes, and she loves her son, even though he is a daily reminder of the sorrows of the past. I imagine she will speak of this to him and explain it as best she can. I hope he will listen and not judge her too severely.
He spoke little of her,
Cray said slowly.
Except to call her cruel for holding back the truth for so long.
Would Thorvald have dealt with it better last year, or the year before? Asked Eyvind mildly. He's still a boy for all his 18 years. He'll come to terms with it in time. The lad still has some growing up to do.
His expression was thoughtful.
Father?
There was a question Cray knew she must ask, although she did not want to hear the answer.
Yes, daughter.
I would not like to think folk would judge Thorvald on the strength of what his father did. It seems unfair that people might think him unsuitable because his father performed an ill deed all those years ago. It seems to me, I think a person of good judgment should disregard that and assess Thorvald on his own merits.
This was very hard to say.
That is what I plan to do. He's still the same person he was yesterday.
Tears were close. She blinked them back. I hope you will remember that when you speak of sending me away to the Northern Isles.
Oh, Cray, Nessa said with a sigh. We wouldn't be sending you away. Don't think of it like that. It's an opportunity. Your circle is so narrow here in Rosie.
Father?
Daughter, I am taken aback that you would think me capable of such prejudice. You should know I always judge a man on his own merits, not on his lineage or the deeds of his kinfolk. Thorvald is not Somerled. He is his own self, and far more Margaret's son than anyone else's. I do not weigh him with the burden of the past on his shoulders.
And yet you want me to go to the Northern Isles and make friends with some chieftain I've never met. He smiled.
And yet I want you to go, although I'll miss that roast mutton terribly.
I have to think about it, Cray said, swallowing hard. It was as good as an edict, what they had said and what they had so carefully not said. We do not think Thorvald a suitable husband for you. She almost wished they were not so sweet and tactful, the two of them, so she could scream and yell and stamp her foot at them. Inside her head was a jumble of feelings clamoring to be released, and there was no way to let them go. Cray rolled up her embroidery and rose to her feet. Good night, father. Sweet dreams, mother. Cray, Nessa began, but Cray had turned her back, heading for bed. It was only when she had snuffed out the lamp and wriggled under the covers next to the sleeping Bruna that she let her tears fall. It wasn't fair. None of it was fair. The ancestors played tricks sometimes and turned things all awry. If she'd been at all interested in Gartnet from the Northern Isles, this would have been simple, since the fellow seemed to view her as a catalogue of feminine virtues, without so much as meeting her once in the flesh. Gartnet was probably exactly as her father had said, a fine specimen of young manhood and utterly suitable to father a future king. Why did she have to love the one man in the world who hardly seemed to see her on some days, and on others, treated her as if she were no different from a boy? It just wasn't fair.
Cray?
Bronna's voice was muffled by layers of blankets.
What's the matter?
Nothing, sniffed Cray, moving closer to the warmth of her sister's body. It might be spring, but the air was bitterly cold, and even in this well-made house, little drafts stirred in corners.
Nothing. Go back to sleep.
It was like a curse, a darkness that would hang over him for the rest of his life, shadowing every step he took. It was one thing to have a heroic dead father whom one had never met, a man who was remembered, still, as leader of the first bold voyage from Norway to the Light Isles. It was quite another to discover your father was a crazed murderer, a tyrant who had unleashed a tide of blood and terror on the islands. Thorvald did not want to acknowledge, even to himself, what that seemed to mean. Striding along the track towards Stensaker, with a violent wind whipping his hair out behind him and tugging his cloak with insistent cold fingers, he shrank from the terrible truth that had hit him like a hammer blow after the first numbing shock of his mother's news. But he could not shut it out. This made sense of everything. His legacy was not Ulf's, but Somerled's, not light, but darkness, not order and sanity, but discord and chaos. This was the missing piece of a puzzle. It told him why he had always felt outside the world of other people, why he could not smile and clasp hands readily, why he turned on those who tried to befriend him, despite himself. It gave the reason why, some days, he felt as if he carried his own gray cloud of misery with him, which nobody else could see. No wonder he'd never fitted in. No wonder he'd never felt a part of things. No wonder he had so few true friends. Thorvald shivered. As his father's son, by rights, he did not deserve friends, most certainly not loyal ones like Cray, who could always be relied upon to listen and wait by him, even when his dark mood made him snap and snarl like a feral cur. Cray would be better off staying right away from him. Who knew when his bad blood would surface? It was not safe for any man to befriend him, nor any woman, least of all a guileless girl like Cray with her cozy domestic pursuits. She was a child and knew nothing of the world. She was innocent of such destructive forces as those he bore hidden inside him. From now on, nobody would be safe. Unless, against all evidence, what they told of Somerled was somehow wrong. If the tale had been twisted and changed, as is the pattern of stories over so many years. If that was so, then maybe there was a glimmer of hope. If his mother said Somerled had killed Ulf, that fact must stand. But perhaps there was a reason for it, a justification. Why had Somerled acted as he did, and what had become of the man? He'd been cast out to sea from the west coast, near the whaleback. Trackless ocean was all that lay before him then, until he reached the rim of the world. What a punishment that was, a penalty grand and terrible enough to belong to an ancient saga, like a burden imposed by a vengeful god or thwarted monarch. That it was Eyvind who had determined it was unbelievable. Cray's father was widely respected in the islands, not just as husband of a royal princess of the folk, but also as a mainstay of the group of landholders who assembled twice yearly at the Thing to maintain order and administer justice. Eyvind was known as scrupulously honest and absolutely fair, a model of strength and honor. But he was most certainly not a man of devious imagination or cunning irony. To devise such a method of exile seemed to Thorvald quite out of character. Maybe there were parts of the story Margaret hadn't told him. Asking Eyvind was just not possible. Pride forbade it. He couldn't talk to his mother. The thought of what she had done disgusted him. If she had such a model husband as Ulf, why lie with some misfit wretch of a brother killer? And how could she not tell her own son all these years? It was this that hurt Thorvald most. Up until now, when he was angry or upset, he had relied on Margaret's grave advice, her calm words to soothe him. When he could see his mother was lonely or out of sorts, he had done his best to divert her with a game or a walk or a tale of what he'd been doing. It had been thus ever since he could remember. Mostly just the two of them, unless you counted Ash hovering silently somewhere in the background. Why his mother kept Ash, Thorvald couldn't comprehend. It was quite clear to him the fellow wanted a bit more than the relationship of trusted servant to mistress of the household, and that Margaret was not in the least interested. A man who would hang around like a stray dog for years and years, waiting for table scraps that never came his way, seemed to Thorvald a lost cause. But silent, poker-faced Ash stayed, while other servants came and went. All the same, they were a small family of two, Thorvald and Margaret, neither much given to open displays of affection, yet trusting and depending on each other. Until now. That closeness was destroyed forever now. She might as well have thrust a blade through his heart, Thorvald thought, kicking savagely at a stone that lay on the track in his way. She might as well have cast him out like his father, away from the paths of right-thinking men and women, so he could be conveniently forgotten. How could he ever forgive her for this? It was late afternoon when he came down the hill past the small settlement of Stensakur, where smoke from cottage fires was whipped sideways by the wind, and the heather thatch shivered, straining at its bindings. Thorvald could see the sea dove making a steady course back to shore, the red-striped sail taut before the gale. His timing was perfect. He must talk to Sam, must tell him as much as he needed to know. He'd have preferred to keep his news to himself, but this was necessary. Thorvald needed a boat. Sam had one. He just hoped Sam would be able to keep his mouth shut. It would be a while before his friend reached the jetty, doubtless with a good catch from the treacherous waters between this northeastern shore of Hrosi and the rising ground of Hrolfsi, which the old folk called Queen's Isle. It was most certainly not the safest place to fish, but Sam was an expert sailor and an astute judge of currents and tides. He had prospered and built his own cottage in Stensakur. He talked of marrying and starting a family. Thorvald saw that ridiculous, and had told his friend so. Being an equable sort of fellow, Sam had only smiled. Not only was this waterway a perilous fishing ground, it also housed the strangest of dwelling places. On the level of Holy Island, situated halfway between the larger isles, lived a community of Christian hermits. The brothers had traveled across the ocean from a land far to the southwest in tiny, frail shells of boats. This small isle, with its weight of lore, had been their chosen home. The folk had shunned the place for generations. It was known to be a dwelling place of the seal tribe, a dangerous people at home, both in water and on land. The women of unearthly beauty, the men so fearsome they could scare a person to death with a single glance of their dark green eyes. Shielded by the courage of their faith, or by blind ignorance, depending on how you looked at it, the brothers had settled on Holy Island nonetheless, and now lived in a well-ordered, though simple fashion, running a few sheep, a goat or two, some chickens. As far as anyone knew, the seal tribe had never bothered them, though it was said that the sea folk were immensely patient and had long memories. Say someone offended them or received a favor. Generations might pass and all seem forgotten, and then, suddenly, there they'd be, demanding vengeance or asking for payment. Because of that, there were very few visitors to Holy Island, and those who made the trip always carried a piece of iron with them for protection. If you forgot this essential item, there was no saying you'd ever get home safely. Sam was one of the few who put in regularly to the brothers' small jetty, with a message or a gift of bread or fresh fish. Sam was a big fellow and not easily frightened. Thorvald waited on the shore, watching as the sea dove bobbed closer. This was a superior kind of craft, a vessel such as a young fisherman like Sam might dream of all his life and never hope to own. Sam had built her for a man called Olaf Ailsen, who had wealth enough to buy in the fine oak from Rogaland. The sea dove was perfect in every detail, from her eye-sweet lines to the sturdy strength of her keel. The lower strakes were of oak, the sheer strake of lighter pine. She was a half-boat, an ocean-going craft, though small. The two pairs of oars she carried were seldom employed, for she went far better under sail, with one man stationed near the stern to handle the steering oar, which was mounted on the starboard side, the other adjusting the trim as required. Sometimes they rowed in and out from the jetty. That was all. Sam had made the sail himself, not trusting any other man in Hrosi with such a critical piece of craftsmanship. On the day she was finished, Olaf Ailsen had taken sick with an ague, and within 7 nights he was dead. But not before he told every one of his kin that nobody was getting their hands on his boat but the man who had made her with such love. If he were to die, the sea dove must be Sam's, for only Sam would use her as she deserved. The half-boat was as well-maintained as any vessel in the islands. Her master had a reputation for thoroughness, for all he was barely 20 years of age. The boards that formed the small decks fore and aft had been replaced last autumn when squalls drove a handy supply of pine trunks up on the beach at scale. The mast could be lowered to rest on a low, crutch-like frame, though Sam never undertook this maneuver at sea. The mast remained in place save when the sea dove was hauled up for work in winter. Every year, Sam's pride and joy was recorked, her hull scraped clean, her thwarts rubbed down with coarse sand, then oiled against the salt water. In the right conditions, the boat could be handled comfortably by two, at least in the coastal waters around Hrosi, which were not without their challenges. All in all, Thorvald thought the sea dove seemed up to a longer voyage. He hoped very much that his friend would agree. Sam had a passenger today. The grey-haired priest stepped out neatly onto the jetty, while Sam and the deckhand tied up the boat and began to unload their catch in a seamless sequence of well-practiced moves. Of all the brothers, it was Tig who was best known in the islands, for it was his practice to travel widely, telling his tales of the Christian faith. Tig was an old friend of both Eyvind and Nessa. A long time ago, he had known Nessa's uncle, the last great king of the Light Isles. His appearance now was remarkably convenient. Thorvald must make the most of the opportunity it offered.
"Go on up to the house, Thorvald," Sam yelled as he hefted a crate of fish onto his shoulder. Take Brother Tig with you and stir up the fire for me. I'll be done here soon.
Thorvald made his way up to the settlement and let himself into Sam's neat cottage, main room open and light with a shuttered window to the east, so you could read the moods of the sea, back room housing sleeping platforms and a separate small hearth, and a snug little shelter beyond for stores of various kinds. Today there appeared to be a broody hen in there, grumbling to herself in a cozy basket of straw. Brother Tig came in behind Thorvald, the skirts of his brown robe blown crazily about him by the fierce wind. He shut the door with some difficulty. Thorvald raked out the embers of the fire, fetched turf, set a kettle to heat. Because there was limited time, he decided to dispense with the niceties.
I want to ask you something.
Go ahead,
said Tig, seating himself by the fledgling fire and reaching down to warm his hands.
I found out about Somerled, that he was my father. My mother told me. You must have known him back then. I want you to tell me what sort of man he was. I want to find out why he killed his brother and...
And what, Thorvald?
The brother did not sound at all perturbed by this volley of difficult questions. The fire was starting to pick up now. Thorvald put on more turf.
And I want you to tell me where you think he would have gone when Eyvind set him adrift. On Holy Island, you've got men who sailed here from far away, men who must know the pattern of the currents out there in the Western Ocean, and where the islands and skerries lie. Tell me what you think. Could he have survived?
Tig did not reply immediately. It looked as if he were rehearsing the words in his head, choosing each one with care.
Tell me! Thorvald demanded. Don't bother to couch it in comforting terms. If you think he would have died, just say so. If you think he was evil and depraved, tell me straight out. My mother held back the truth for 18 years. I've no patience for falsehoods, nor for polite half-truths. Whatever you have to say, it can be no worse than finding out I've lived a lie my whole life.
You're a young man, Thorvald,
Tig observed, regarding him gravely.
You have many years ahead of you. It is those years that matter, not the ones that are past. What your father was and where he went makes no real difference. It's your own life you are living, not Somerled's.
Spare me your philosophy, Thorvald snapped.
Give me facts. Why did my father kill Ulf? Is it true that he single-handedly wiped out most of the islanders before Eyvind stopped him?
You wish me to answer before your friend arrives home. These are big questions, Thorvald.
Please.
It took some effort to get this word out. Still, he saw understanding in the priest's grey eyes and heard compassion in his voice. It was expedient to take a deep breath and attempt calm if he were to have a chance of getting the answers he needed.
Only Somerled could tell you why he killed his brother, Tig said. There seemed obvious reasons, the lust for power, jealousy, and frustration that there was no real role for him here. His feelings for your mother, perhaps. There were older reasons, which he brought with him from Rogaland, matters of the distant past. You need to ask Eyvind about those.
Eyvind?
Why? The two of them were close friends, blood brothers. It was in a sense of responsibility for Somerled's ill deeds that Eyvind banished him. He could have killed him. Instead, he chose a way that gave his friend a second chance. It was a wise and generous decision.
A second chance? A chance to sail over the edge of the world and perish?
That is one possibility, agreed Tig evenly.
You think there are others? Tell me.
I will, Thorvald. One answer at a time. Somerled brought a weight of trouble with him when he came here with his brother's expedition. Ulf was a friend of mine. We spoke much during his all too brief season as chieftain here. For all Somerled was his own brother, Ulf feared him greatly. It was not on his invitation that Somerled came here, but at the behest of the Jarl back home. Ulf was under pressure to agree since the Jarl had financed his venture. The result was catastrophic. Somerled did terrible things as leader here.
He was a clever man, subtle, ingenious. It was also completely ruthless. It seemed to me he had no awareness at all of the suffering of others. It was as if some essential part of a man's understanding were closed to him, and always had been. It is troubling to consider that, had it not been for Eyvind's intervention and Nessa's, he would have remained king here, and none of the island folk would have survived. Your father believed the Norse people to be superior in every way, and far better fitted to rule. He saw no place here for folk he believed to be primitive, weak, and ineffectual. He'd have wiped them out entirely. Somerled never understood them. He never understood the islands. He'd have killed Nessa. She was too influential to be left alive. Eyvind, too. At one point, both the Wolfskin and myself were imprisoned and on the verge of execution. Somerled did not take kindly to hearing the truth if it happened not to suit his own purposes.
There seemed to be nothing for Thorvald to say. He had asked for answers, after all. Too bad if it hurt to hear them, when he had believed nothing could hurt much after what his mother had told him.
King, he said finally, his tone hollow.
Indeed, that was his lifelong ambition, so Eyvind told me. For a short while he achieved it. The cost was high.
Thorvald felt a bitter laugh escaping from his throat.
Ha! Just think, if he'd stayed on here, I might have been king after him. King Thorvald. Very amusing, that. And Ayanna would never have been born, nor Cray, nor the others. Thank the gods he was sent away. As ruler here, I would probably have turned out just like him.
We must concern ourselves with the path that was taken, not the one abandoned, Tig said, using an iron hook to lift the kettle's lid and see if the water was boiling.
You want to know where he might have gone? Why?
This one must be answered carefully.
He was my father.
It is of some interest to me whether he lived or died.
I can speak of possibilities, Thorvald, but nobody can say what happened. Your mother told you, I imagine, that there has been no news of Somerled since that day. No sign at all that he ever reached safe shore. All I can give you is surmise.
That'll do, Thorvald said, trying not to sound too interested. It was important that nobody got any hint of what he intended to do.
Very well. Under conditions such as were apparent that day, my guess is that the boat might have travelled somewhat north of due west, perhaps sharply north. We have no proof that there's land of any significance to the west, but there are some very strange tales. I heard that a fellow came into the Northern Isles some time back in a state of shock so severe it was almost as if he had lost his wits entirely. He was one of our own kind and had sailed the same path as I did, but was blown off course by contrary winds and failed to touch shore in the Light Isles. His words were a stream of nonsense, but he seemed to be telling of a sojourn of 2 or 3 seasons on another group of islands farther to the northwest. They'd be several days sailing from here at least, and maybe considerably more, since we've heard so few reports of such a place. 1 or 2 other accounts do seem to confirm their existence. That would be the last land of the west, a marginal place. It would be easy to miss it. Should your father's craft have drifted somewhat northward, it is possible he may have reached that shore.
Thorvald's heart was thumping.
Why was the man in such a state of mind? He asked eagerly. Was he deranged by the journey itself, or something more?
Tig frowned.
My account is third hand, of course. The fellow was terrified out of his wits. They could get little sense from him. He was frightened of staying by the seashore, as if he expected an enemy to come from the water. He spoke of stealing children, and of some kind of singing. It was quite odd. Very probably his long voyage on the isolation had caused these waking nightmares. It's not the easiest experience. A man's faith can be sorely tested.
Yes, well, that's the way you do it, isn't it?
Tig smiled.
Indeed. And I will be honest with you. I have often wondered whether such a voyage would change Somerled for the better, as Eyvind hoped it would.
Perhaps he was unable to change, Thorvald said. He could hear the crunch of Sam's boots on the path outside. Maybe he was so evil that he could never redeem himself.
Aye,
Tag observed.
While we cannot say what did happen to your father, I can tell you one of God's most profound truths, and you would be wise to ponder it, Thorvald. No man is quite beyond salvation. God's grace is in all of us. If nurtured well, that little flame may grow into a radiant goodness. We are all his creatures. We are part of him. To change, all we need do is learn to love him. Even Somerled could do that. You must believe it possible that he did so in his own way.
The arrival of Sam with a string of pale-bellied fish dangling from one hand and his bundle of gear grasped in the other put an end to that conversation. Cups were filled with ale, a meal was cooked, and easy talk flowed. Of the weather, of the arrival of new lambs on the brothers' small farm, of a forthcoming wedding and the death of an old man down at Hafnarfjarðar. That was where Tig was heading, quite away. Sam offered him a bed for the night, but the priest refused. He'd a lift arranged with a local farmer. Indeed, he'd best be heading over there now, before it got too dark. They'd sleep at the fellow's house and take the cart on in the morning with a load of vegetables and some chickens for the market. Tig wiped his plate clean with a scrap of bread, then rose to depart.
Remember what I told you, Thorvald, he said mildly. Take time to consider. On reflection, a monster can become no more than a fleeting shadow, an unassailable mountain, a gentle rise. You are young. You rush to seek answers, heedless of the cost. If you allow time, you may find that all you need to do is wait.
Thorvald let him finish. There was no point in arguing. The truth was simple. He bore his father's legacy, and it marked him as surely as Eivind's courage and goodness had marked his small son Kinnart. If that child had not been snatched by the sea, he'd doubtless have grown up into the sort of leader folk followed to the ends of the earth. Tig had missed the point. To know himself, to look into his own spirit, Thorvald must find out what kind of man his father truly was. And there was only one way that could be done. It was perilous. His mother wouldn't like it. Sam would take a lot of convincing. Nonetheless, he must attempt it, or forever live with the knowledge that he had not faced up to the truth. If his father still lived, he would find him. It was a quest, grand, challenging, heroic. Do this, and his life might come to mean something after all. Sam was not easily surprised. He listened calmly to the story. Margaret, Somerled, Ulf, battles and blood, murder and exile. From time to time he sipped his ale and nodded. Once or twice he frowned. One of the reasons Sam had remained a friend for so long was his talent for calm. He was almost as good a listener as Cray, and a lot less inclined to make helpful suggestions when they weren't wanted. When Thorvald came to the end of the tale, Sam did not comment at once. He poked the fire, topped up his friend's ale, and let a cat in the back door, all in complete silence.
You want to borrow the sea dove,
he stated eventually, his blue eyes thoughtful.
Not exactly, replied Thorvald, a wave of relief sweeping through him that Sam had understood this part of it without needing to be told.
I'm not enough of a sailor to take her there myself. You'd have to come with me. I could pay you, if that would help.
Sam's brows lifted a little. He took a mouthful of ale.
How long do you plan being away? From full moon to full moon? Or maybe a season? Perhaps more if the wind carries you astray. There's a lot of fish to be caught in such a time, enough to pay for a fellow's wedding and furnish his cottage nice and snug. Best woolens, fine linens, a piece of seasoned wood for a cradle. Enough to cover his hand's wages. What if the boat's damaged? That's my livelihood down there, Thorvald. She may be a sturdy craft, but she's not made for that kind of ocean voyaging.
The words were less than encouraging. On the other hand, there was a certain note in Sam's voice, a
and a certain glint in his eye that showed his interest had been sparked.
It needn't be long.
Thorvald leaned forward, elbows on knees, keen to press what little advantage he had.
Brother Tige didn't seem to think it was very far. We could be there and back again almost before anyone knows it. We could tell them.
Sam raised a hand, cutting off the flow of words.
Not so fast. What about when we get there? If we get there. You're planning to pop in, announce that you're this fellow's son, then sail right home again. What if you can't find him? What if you do and he wants you to stay? Where does that leave me?
The smile that curved Thorvald's lips felt like a mockery.
I assure you that won't happen. I'm not expecting to be greeted with open arms, even supposing we do find what we're looking for. I've no intention at all of staying there. All I want is the answer to a question. And what question's that?
Sam asked, stroking the cat, which had curled itself on his lap in a ball of grey-striped contentment, purring like a simmering kettle. But Thorvald did not reply, and the silence lengthened between them.
I'll think about it, Sam said eventually. But I'll be straight with you, Thorvald. I can't see much in it for me beyond helping an old friend.
One last adventure before you settle down, Thorvald suggested. One last foray as a single man.
You worry me with your talk of cradles. I did say I'd pay.
Sam nodded slowly.
If I agreed, it'd be as a favor to a friend. I'd expect that to be returned sometime. Of course, I'll do whatever you want, Thorvald offered eagerly.
The fact was such a favor would be easily repaid, since Sam never asked more of him than a day's help on the boat, or a hand with laying thatch. His friend was easily pleased.
Sam said with a funny look in his eyes. I'll hold you to that, Thorvald. Give me a day or two to think about this. One thing, though, in open water you'll need a crew of four at least. We'd have to get another couple of fellows in on it, and they'd certainly want to be paid. No.
Thorvald had wondered when Sam would get to this. He had known there needed to be a good answer to it, but the look on his friend's face told him none of those he had thought up was going to be sufficient.
I can't have anyone else. Asking you to come along is one thing. Getting other men to do it is another thing altogether. As soon as we started asking about, the whole island would know. This is secret, Sam. It has to be just you and me. You've told me often enough how well the sea dove goes under sail, and it's not very far. We could do it easily. Don't you go out every day with just your deckhand to help you? You're crazy, Sam said flatly. I wouldn't so much as consider it, not without one more man at least. You seem pretty confident about how far it is. I thought we didn't know that for sure. Brother Tige said a few days' sail. Folk would hardly get the chance to miss us.
A lie, that, almost certainly.
Come on, Sam. This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. A true adventure. An adventure isn't worth having if you never get back to tell the tale, Sam observed flatly.
There was a brief silence.
So you won't even consider it? Thorvald asked, watching his friend closely. Not as a test of your boat, or of yourself. Not at any price.
Sam's mouth stretched in a faint grin.
At any price? You're not as rich as that, Thorvald, however good a farm your mother runs. Now tell me, did you mean what you said about returning the favor? Say I do it, and then what I ask you isn't to your liking. Will you stay true to what you promised?
Thorvald's heart leaped. Evidently, there was still hope.
Of course, he said with complete confidence.
He could not think of a thing Sam could ask for that he would not be prepared to deliver.
I gave you my word, didn't I? I know how much you'd be risking, Sam. If you do this, I'll be in your debt forever. If I do it, I'll be as mad as you are, Sam muttered. Well, I'll give it some thought and let you know. Maybe we could pick up a crew in the Northern Isles, fellows that don't know you, if that's what matters. That'd be a lot to organize. It must be kept secret, Thorvald put in quickly.
I'd be stopped if they knew. My mother, Eyvind, any of them. You mustn't tell Cray.
You're a grown man,
Sam observed, rising to his feet. The cat, dislodged, fell bonelessly to the floor and strolled away unperturbed.
All the same, they'd think this foolish, dangerous. They chose not to speak of my father all those years. They made a decision to forget him. It's hardly likely they'll want him brought to life now, when he so conveniently faded into the mists of memory.
Still, said Sam, your mother did tell you.
Thorvald shivered.
So she did, he agreed. More fool her. A bit hard on her, aren't you?
Thorvald did not reply, but later, while Sam slept as tranquilly as a babe, he lay awake pondering this, wondering if he had been entirely fair to Margaret. There was no doubt in his mind that she should have told him the truth earlier, not saved it for now, then expected him to absorb, understand, and forgive, as if this were a small everyday matter. On the other hand, she'd been young back in those days, younger than he was now. And perhaps Somerled had not been what people said. Perhaps there'd been reasons for what he did, reasons nobody else understood. Maybe he'd been like Thorvald, an outsider, a man with few friends, a person too clever for his own good. Thorvald lay staring up at the roof thatch, listening to the purring of the cat as it kneaded the blankets behind Sam's knees. The fisherman sighed, turning over. Thorvald considered the implications of his plan. There was no doubt he would hurt people he cared about, his mother and Cray especially. It was a long voyage, almost certainly longer than he had given Sam to believe, and there were no guarantees of safe landfall. Somerled might not be there, might not ever have been there. He might have perished long since, somewhere out at sea alone in his little boat. When she learned what he had done, Margaret would be horrified. Cray would be hurt that he had not confided in her. She was accustomed to sharing his inmost fears, his frustrations, his schemes and plans. This he could not tell her. He must hope she would forgive when he returned, if he returned. One thing was certain. This was a journey he was bound to undertake, bound by his blood.
Chapter 2.
Monk's margin note reads, Three tides on western shores. Whale harvest, blood tide. Night of voices, death tide. Isle of clouds, fool's tide. Cray's weaving was almost finished, a soft blanket of finest wool, vivid red on deepest blue. The decorative borders with their pattern of foxes, owls, and little trees had already been done on the strip loom. Cray would sew the pieces together to produce a seamless effect. Margaret asked her what project she would start on next, but Cray could not answer. For some reason, there didn't seem to be a next, not right now. Perhaps she would go to the Northern Isles as her parents wanted, she told her aunt. It might not be a good time to embark on a new piece of work. And there was always the journey, that very private embroidery, which seemed to grow and grow, and never quite be finished to her satisfaction. Don't worry about Thorvald, Aunt Margaret told her bluntly one afternoon, when the two of them were beginning to fasten off the warp heads, working side by side as late afternoon sun slanted in through the open doorway, touching the colored wool to fiery brightness. He'll come home when he's ready. He told you what this is about, I suppose.
Some of it,
Cray said awkwardly. It was difficult to approach such a subject, even though Aunt Margaret was a trusted friend. But this was not just about secrets. It concerned murder and betrayal, and it was beyond imagining that neat, self-sufficient Margaret, a woman who displayed none of the signs of a passionate nature, had ever been embroiled in such high drama.
I know he's unhappy, Cray went on. I'd like to help him, but...
A man can't be helped if he doesn't want it, Margaret said. You'd be best to leave him alone, Cray. Thorvald has to work this out for himself. Your father's right. A trip away would be good for you. Cray said nothing. Margaret might think Thorvald was off brooding somewhere and would come home when he'd forgiven her. Cray knew better. Thorvald was away visiting Sam again. Sometimes it seemed to Cray that Thorvald thought she was stupid, just as he thought the pastimes she loved so much, weaving, sewing, cooking, were women's pursuits, requiring little in the way of cleverness. She knew she was not stupid. She could tell Thorvald was planning an expedition. He was going to find his father, and Sam would be traveling with him. It took two men to sail the Sea Dove. If Margaret had not worked that out, she knew her son less well than she imagined. This was going to be a challenge. It might be quite a long way, and Cray had never enjoyed the motion of a boat, not even the small fairing they used to take out when they were children. But one thing was for certain. For all his 18 years, Thorvald was not very grown up at all, and had no idea how to look after himself. And whatever anyone might say about him, he was deserving of her help, of her love. People looked at Thorvald and saw only the bad side, the gloomy moods, the sudden anger, the silences. Cray knew him better. He had been her friend as long as she could remember. He had been there the day Kinnart died, a terrible long-ago day when her parents were too shattered by shock and grief to take heed of their little daughter. Cray had stood quietly in the shadows, watching as the cold, pale form of her brother was laid out on the table to be washed and dried, and prayed over and cried over. Margaret had come, and Thorvald with her, himself still a small child. It was Thorvald who had settled by Cray's side, wiped away her tears, warmed her hands in his. It was he who had kept away the terror of the unknown that day, when her whole world went awry. And later, there were many more times, times when she had been sad or upset, and he had heard her catalogue of woes in accepting silence, and told her it would be all right. Times when he got her out of trouble. She could remember a trip out on the lake in a forbidden boat, a capsize, and an embarrassing rescue. If not for Thorvald that day, she might herself have drowned. If not for his help, she'd most certainly have had to go home in wet clothes and confess her stupidity to her parents. Then there was the reading and writing, something Cray had always found immensely difficult. She'd struggled with Margaret's lessons, for her attention kept straying to the things she'd rather be doing, baking, embroidery, or just being out of doors in the fresh air. Thorvald had helped her then, adding his own unofficial tuition to Margaret's formal sessions. He'd sit with Cray down by the western dike and watch gravely as she made letters in the earth with a pointed stick. He never got cross when he was teaching her. It was her own fault that she hadn't been able to learn. There was no doubt in Cray's mind that that patient teacher, that kindly child, represented the real Thorvald, the essence of the man he would become. Other folk might see him as arrogant, unfeeling, even cruel. There was no doubt he could be all of these. His true face, Cray thought, he showed only to those he trusted, and there were precious few of them. All the same, right now he was still unpredictable and moody, and still prone to sullen, illogical decisions. He must not undertake such a grand adventure without her by his side. Once she had decided this, there were plans to be made. There was no way Thorvald and Sam would agree to take her with them, so she'd have to stow away. That meant finding out when they were leaving and getting to Stensaker the night before. How long would they be gone? Which way were they going? And how could she do it without worrying Eyvind and Nessa half to death? The very thought of it made her belly churn with unease. There was such danger in it, peril and uncertainty. Thorvald must have asked around, of course, though she knew he had not spoken to Eyvind. He must have found out the likeliest route, the probable landfall for Somerled's lonely voyage. Surely Sam, the most practical man in Rosi, would not have agreed to take him if there had not been suitable safeguards. All the same, there were questions hanging over the very idea. What had it come from, after all, but a chance remark of her own about finding out the truth? Perhaps their destination was far away. Perhaps they would be gone a long time, a whole cycle of the moon or even two. Her mother would be anxious, her father shocked. Eyvind would be furious with Thorvald, even though her presence on the boat would be all her own doing. He might even take into his head to come after them, though there was no other vessel in the Light Isles that could match Sam's for speed and maneuverability. Her father could hardly commandeer a longship. And what about Margaret? Who would help her with the weaving? Who would comfort her when she discovered her son had abandoned home and hearth in a wild search for a father he had never known? All the same, Cray knew that she must go. It was knowledge that owed little to logic, but was nonetheless deep and strong. A conviction that beat in the heart and flowed in the blood. She must be there. Without her, Thorvald could not do this. Without her, this quest would fail. She was careful to follow her usual routine, making herself useful at home, walking or riding down to Aunt Margaret's most days. Her parents talked about her trip to the Northern Isles again, and she pretended to be thinking about it. It was not a good feeling to deceive them. The household was built on trust and truth. She longed to seek their wise advice, but could not, knowing they would never agree to let her go on such a voyage. Her sister Bruna was the only one who sensed there was something wrong, and it was Bruna who helped Cree find a way. A wedding was to be held near Stensaker. Grimm's eldest daughter, Sigrid, was marrying a farmer from West Island, and the whole family was invited. The day before they were to head eastward for the festivities, a messenger came with news that the chieftains of the Cat had sent a delegation to Hafnarfjörður, wanting to speak with Eyvind about some kind of arrangement to protect the straits between the Light Isles and their own northern coastline. The traffic of Norse and Danish vessels in those parts had picked up considerably, and one could never be sure whether an attacker might decide to help himself to a cargo of livestock or fine timber, furs or thralls. It was necessary for Eyvind to travel south immediately, and Nessa, who was looking tired and pale these days, made a sudden decision to stay at home with Ingegerd, rather than go to the wedding without her husband. Nessa did not want to disappoint her daughters. Cree and Bruna could still go, she decreed, as long as they traveled there and back with the three men Eyvind had chosen to accompany and guard them, and stayed with Grimm and his wife, Eira, until the celebrations were over. Margaret was not going, and nor was Thorvald. At around the same time, Cray had an amazing piece of luck. One of Eyvind's housecarls, a girl called Solvig, was walking out with the fellow who worked on the Sea Dove as deckhand. When Solvig happened to mention that Sam was giving her sweetheart an unexpected holiday soon after the coming weekend, it all fell into place. There could only be one reason, Cray thought, for a decision that would cost Sam dearly in lost fish. The Sea Dove must be almost ready to leave, and she herself would be close to Stensaker at just the right time. Perfect. It almost seemed meant to be. The hurt she was about to inflict on her family weighed heavily on Cray, but her mind was made up. The two girls packed their bags, a good gown each for the wedding. Cray's prized string of amber beads, Bruna's favorite yellow ribbon, two pairs of fine stockings of white wool. Gifts for the happy couple had already been stowed away. There was a box carved with images of whales and seals in pale soapstone, holding a good weight of silver pieces, and a woolen wall hanging of Cray's own making, which showed a magical tree whose limbs held fruit and foliage of many shapes and hues, apple, pear, and berry, all springing from the same branch. Cray was glad the blue and red blanket had not been given away as yet. She was pleased her handiwork was so prized, but it was always sad to see it go, for there was a part of herself in every piece she crafted. Thorvald would think that silly. It was the sort of thing she could not tell him. Her mind wandered ahead to the time when the two of them would be man and wife. Perhaps the blue and red blanket might cover the bed they would share. She imagined waking as the dawn light streamed in across the rich colors of the wool. She felt the warmth of Thorvald's body against hers, the strength of his arm around her. Cray? She started. Bruna must have said something, and she hadn't even heard her. Why are you packing that? Bruna asked, staring at the rolled up linen of the journey, which Cray was tucking into the outer pocket of her bag. We'll only be there a few days, and there'll be feasting and dancing every night. You won't get any time for sewing. I'm not taking mine. It can't hurt, Cray said, glad her sister had not noticed some of the other items she had packed. A sharp knife, a length of strong cord, a bar of soap, a roll of soft cloths in case she had her monthly bleeding before they sailed back home, a pair of shears, a piece of flint, bone needles, colored wool, herbs to counter seasickness. At the bottom of the bag was an old shirt and trousers of Thorvald's, removed surreptitiously from one of Aunt Margaret's storage chests, and a warm felt hat with ear flaps. Thorvald's clothes did not fit her very well. Her figure was not of the kind one would call boyish. Still, she suspected this would be a voyage ill-suited to her fine linen gowns and soft woolen tunics. It would be wet and cold until they got there, wherever there was. She must be practical.
Cray?
Queried Brona, staring as her sister fastened the strap around her bundle of belongings.
What?
That's a big bag.
So's yours.
Not as big as yours.
What is this, a competition?
Brona frowned. She was a slight, wide-eyed girl, with soft brown hair like Nessa's, and a sweet look about her that did not quite conceal her sharp mind.
Cray, you wouldn't be planning something, would you? You've been acting very strangely this last little while.
Planning? What could I possibly be planning? Cray raised her eyebrows in what she hoped was an expression of innocent surprise. Brona put her hands on her hips.
Planning to run off with Sam, that's what, she snapped. You'd better not be doing that, because if you marry Sam, I'll never speak to you again. Not even when I'm a wrinkled old crone with no teeth.
There wouldn't be much point in speaking to me if you had no teeth, Cray retorted as relief swept through her, closely followed by the spark of a very useful idea. Brona had come alarmingly near to the truth, and yet had missed it entirely.
I wouldn't be able to understand a word. Mind you, I'd probably be deaf as a post myself by then.
Well? Glowered Brona.
Are you?
Of course not, Cray said. Seeing that her sister was almost in tears, and marveling that she had not noticed how much of a woman Brona had become, so wrapped up had she been in her own concerns.
Sam's not exactly the running away kind, Brona. If he wanted something, he'd just ask for it.
So has he?
Has he what?
Asked you to marry him. Asked father for your hand. I know he made you a comb. I've seen him looking at you.
No, Brona, Cray said, sitting down on the bed and putting an arm around her sister's slender shoulders. Sam hasn't asked, and I don't expect him to.
This was not the time to tell Brona that it was possible their father might consider kindly, hard-working Sam no more suitable as a prospective son-in-law than he did Thorvald.
But I do have a secret. You guessed that right.
What? Brona's attention was instantly seized by this. The calculating look on her face showed she was sifting the possibilities, all of which probably had a young man in them. Brona had always been fond of tales of romance.
I'll tell you when we get to Grimm and Ada's, but only if you swear to keep it secret.
Why should I swear?
I'll tell you that once we get there too.
Told just enough and no more, Cray thought, her sister might prove immensely useful both to cover for her own departure and to soften the bad news for Eyvind and Nessa. Judging by the look in Brona's eyes whenever the name Sam was mentioned, it wouldn't be very hard to dream up a return favor.
Now let's take these bags out to the horses and say our goodbyes. I hope it's not going to rain. Make sure you put your winter boots on.
Eyvind had already left, riding halfway to Hafnarfjarðar at dawn with a group of his most trusted men. They would collect ash on the way. Margaret's taciturn steward was a man valued for his ability to ease the awkwardness of negotiations on tricky subjects by summarizing, clarifying, and suggesting useful compromises. Eyvind had once remarked that ash had acquired this useful skill by living in the same household as Thorvald and Margaret, neither of whom was known for a pliant disposition. If Ash could survive that, the fearsome chieftains of the cat should present him with little difficulty. Nessa bade her daughters farewell with a grave kiss on either cheek. She spoke quietly, first to Bruna, then to Cray, while Bruna was hugging her small sister one last time.
Be safe, daughter, Nessa said softly, her grey eyes gazing with alarming clarity into Cray's own. This is a branching of the path for you. I've seen it. There will be a choice of ways, and some of them trouble me.
You looked in the fire for me, Cray whispered. Her mother had once been a powerful priestess. She'd given that up to wed Eyvind, but the skills she'd learned were deep and enduring. She'd helped train Ayana in the arts, and Cray knew that her mother still used them herself when the need arose. The images in flame, the voices in earth, the song of wind and waves each told a little of the ancestors' wisdom and the paths ahead.
What have you seen?
A journey. A finding and losing. Death, love, hurt.
I cannot tell if this is a tale encompassed by a single waxing and waning of the moon, or over a far longer span.
There's a strangeness and terror in it that makes me want to keep you here at home, safe where you belong.
But I can't. The ancestors don't lie to us.
Cray shivered. Her mother's eyes were shadowed now.
Have you told Father about this? About what you saw?
No, Nessa said.
I'll stay home if you want.
Cray's words tumbled out in a rush.
You don't look well. I did wonder.
Nessa smiled, and the sudden chill was gone as quickly as it had come.
I'm fine, daughter. And I'll do well enough with Ingeir to keep me company until you girls come home. Enjoy yourselves. It will do you good to have some dancing and fun. Perhaps for you the path branches only as far as the Northern Isles and a certain fine young man. What happens will be your own choice.
Now go on, the men are waiting. Is this your bundle? What have you got in here, a loom and a sack of wool?
Then small Ingeir began to cry, and Nessa gathered her up with soothing words, and all at once it was time to go. Cray looked back over her shoulder as her mother's slender figure grew smaller and smaller, standing in the doorway with Ingeir in her arms, and a brave smile on her face, not quite concealing the unease in her eyes. A shiver ran through Cray. How long would it be before she saw them again? And what, oh what, would her mother say when she learned Cray had sailed away in a little boat toward the edge of the world?
In the end, it was almost too easy. The first night of the wedding celebrations, Sam came up from the settlement in his best tunic with the red embroidery and joined in the dancing. It was quite a party. Grim's wife, Aira, had not stinted on the ale, and Grim himself had slaughtered a couple of pigs to complement the usual spread of fish and baked goods. A woman called Zyra, who was famous for her cakes, had made a splendid confection with bear flour and honey, and nuts and spices brought over on a knarr from Norway. The goods had their origin in markets far east, places so far away they were like something in a dream. Zyra herself had come from just such a distant land. She was a fine dancer, and as her husband Thord was away at the same council as Eyvind, she partnered one man after another with her dark hair flying and her red lips smiling. She was a little flirtatious, Cray judged, but there was no harm in it. Scarred, gap-toothed Thord, a man built like a monolith, had kept this lively woman's heart since he'd been awarded her as some sort of prize long ago in another land. Pairings did not follow any strict pattern of culture or kinship in the Light Isles. Look at the bride herself. Her father had once been a wolfskin warrior, and her mother, much younger, bore island blood at its purest. Look at Eyvind and Nessa. Cray herself was part of two races. A suitor who could show he was strong and good, and able to provide for a family, might gain approval regardless of his origins. It was a little different for Cray and her sisters. If one's sons were to be some kind of kings, one could not wed just any man, though it might seem to some people that Nessa herself had done just that. Eyvind was a Norseman, and had once been a warrior servant of Thor.
His people had been the enemy, the invaders who had brought devastation to the islands before valor and magic had put an end to that brutal season of conflict. But Eyvind had been as carefully chosen as any princeling or jarl. Both Nessa and her old teacher, Rona, had subjected him to trials of their own, trials in which he had proved his mettle not just as a warrior, but as stalwart protector, strong in courage and goodness, wise and loving. If ever a man were fit to be a father of kings, it was he. Cray sighed. Today she had extracted Brona's promise of silence, and in return made a promise of her own. Yes, she had told her sister, if Sam asked you know what, Cray would say no. In addition, she'd do everything she could to ensure Sam turned his attentions to Brona herself, who was nearly 15 after all, and would be quite ready for marriage in a year or two. Everyone knew Sam wanted to settle down as soon as he was satisfied the house was cozy enough. He was saving his profits and making it all perfect for just that purpose. Seeing the look on Brona's face, Cray knew her sister's determination. It was going to be Brona lying under those fine woolen blankets, cooking a hearty meal for her man's return, and providing a bouncing baby boy for the new cradle, and not any other girl on the islands. So Cray promised, and did not say perhaps a fisherman was not the right father for a king, however pleasant a fellow he might happen to be. And in return, Brona gave her word to keep quiet for a certain length of time, long enough so it would be too late for someone to take a boat and set off in pursuit with any likelihood of finding the sea dove in open water. After that, Brona would tell Nessa and Eyvind what Cray had instructed her to tell, a task that would demand no little courage. Cray knew the bargain was unfair. Though Brona wouldn't believe it, she'd never wanted Sam for herself. She liked him, everyone did, but Cray could never put another man before Thorvald. It was as simple as that. A pity Sam himself didn't see it the same way. He was coming across the room toward her with a purposeful tread now, and there was a certain look in his steady blue eyes that worried her. Brona was down the other end with a group of girls. Brona was watching.
"Will you dance, Cray?"
Sam asked politely, sketching a little bow that, from another man, would have looked ridiculous. Sam had a natural dignity and could get away with it. Cray took his hand and they moved into the circle. Brona was frowning. This was not part of any bargain. The music struck up again and the circle began to move this way and that, hands clasped, feet light, or not so light, in the steps of a chain dance. There was a lot of noise, folk chattering, whistles and drum in lively discourse, boots stamping on the earthen floor.
"You're looking well, Cray,"
Sam yelled above the general din.
"You too,"
Cray shouted back.
"I didn't think you'd be here."
"I like a good party."
Sam grinned as the circle broke into couples and began a weaving in and out motion.
"A late night,"
Cray observed.
"If you have to take the boat out at dawn, or before."
"Ah, well,"
said Sam, whirling her around in a circle rather faster than the other men were doing with their partners.
"I might take a day off, work on the cottage."
Cray nodded. She needed to ask just the right questions, not to sound too inquisitive.
"Will you be coming again tomorrow night? Grimm says there will be games. I don't know what kind."
Sam drew her adroitly back into the circle. Now Brona was on his other side, partnered by young Hawken, Grimm's son. Sam winked, and a delicate blush rose to Brona's cheeks. Sam turned back to Cray.
"Games, is it? Well, I suppose I'll miss those. Going on a bit of a trip. I may be away a few days, perhaps longer. Up north. No late night for me tomorrow. Heading off at sunup next day."
"Oh,"
Cray said lightly, though her heart was thudding with excitement. It had been easy, after all. He'd come right out with the information she needed. Only another day to wait, and then she would creep out while the games were on, and the pattern of the dance changed again, and she found herself with a tongue-tied farmhand, while behind her, Sam danced with Brona. A glance over her shoulder showed her the two of them were not talking at all. Indeed, her normally voluble sister appeared quite lost for words,
though Brona cut a graceful figure as she moved to the music, her large grey eyes fixed on her partner's with a sweetly solemn expression. Brona's pale complexion was still touched with pink in the cheeks. At least Sam was looking at her. It was a start. The unfortunate part of it was that Brona did not quite comprehend Sam's role in the expedition to come. How could Cray tell her that she was, indeed, running off with the object of her sister's affections, though not at all in the way Brona would have understood it? There would be some explaining to do when she got back. Well, fate had delivered exactly what she wanted. Games tended to be noisy and accompanied by a generous flow of ale. Nobody would notice her slipping away. She must trust Brona to hold her tongue until long after it was discovered she was missing. Brona knew she would be with Thorvald, and why, and the general sort of direction they were going in. As long as Eyvind did not leap into a boat and head straight after them, always possible, then the voyage would unfold as it must. So she just had to creep out of Grimm's house, find the sea dove, get on board and hide, put up with a certain amount of discomfort until the right time came, and then she would deal with that part of it when it happened, Cray told herself. She must put her fears to the back of her mind, that the weather would be bad, that the boat would sink, that they would sail on and never find their destination. She must set aside the guilt. She could not afford to picture her father furious, her mother frantic, Margaret grieving, Brona in trouble because of her. If she thought about these things, she might be tempted to change her mind. And that inner voice, the powerful, deep voice that was both part of her and at the same time outside her, was making it very clear that she must go on with this. She had made the decision. Thorvald needed her, and she would be there for him, as so often in the past her friend had been for her. She would be strong. As for the aftermath, she would deal with that when it came. Frightening it was, he had to admit. Frightening and exhilarating, as the sea dove fought a precarious way northwestward, now sliding down to the dark trough of a wave, as if she would carry them relentlessly on into the very depths of this watery kingdom, now riding high, steeply rising over the peak of a monstrous surge that surely, surely she could not breast. Surely they'd be smashed in splinters. Sam barked out terse instructions, and Thorvald, tight-jawed in a strange blend of excitement and terror, obeyed them as best he could, fighting to keep the quivering boat on some sort of stable course. And realizing it had not been very wise to talk Sam out of taking a third man with them from Stensakur. The plan had been to sail as far as the Northern Isles and pick up a crewman or two who didn't know either of them. That way they'd have sufficient numbers for the difficult bit. The trouble was, things were already more difficult than anything Thorvald had experienced. The sky was wild with shredded clouds. The sea was a fractious monster with a mind and a will there was no gainsaying. If it wanted to gobble them up, men, craft, provisions, it would do so as casually as a dog snatches a morsel dropped from the table. In truth, Thorvald loved it. The gale whipped all confusion from his mind, the ache in his back, the blisters on his palms. The constant struggle to keep firm footing emptied him of all but the will to stay alive just a little longer and not lose Sam's fine boat for him. He was on a mission. It was good. Today he was a man. Their course was somewhat farther westward than Thorvald had expected. Once out of the sheltered waters of the Light Isles, they'd made good speed, for the wind had been favorable for a straight course to their destination. After a quick debate with himself, Sam had made the decision. They would head northwest, abandoning the plan to go by the Northern Isles and pick up one or two extra men, since that would add at least 2 days to the trip either way. Things were going well, but they were managing. And the sooner they got there, Sam said, the sooner they'd be home again. He didn't want his deckhand defecting in the absence of paid work. It would take him too long to train another. When they found these islands, Thorvald could talk to his mysterious father, Sam would do a spot of fishing, and then they'd come home. From half moon to full, should see the trip accomplished, and the two of them back where they should be. So it was straight out into open sea, with no more than guesswork to guide them,
Sam did not use sunstones, since the sea dove fished solely in the coastal waters of the Light Isles, where cliff, dune, and skerry were the only markers a man needed. But he watched the light and the clouds, and eyed the birds passing overhead on their wind-harried journeys. And as dusk fell, Thorvald could see him squinting upward, working out what the patterns of sun and moon could tell him. It had grown calmer. For a while, Thorvald had wondered if they would both have to stay awake all night, clinging to line or thwart or steering oar, as the sea clutched and released, heaved and subsided. But the gods had had enough of playing for now, and the sea dove settled, creaking, to a gently swaying movement. They lashed the steering oar in place and dragged a sea anchor, heavy rope with a conical bag attached, to slow their progress. It might be possible for each to snatch a little sleep, while the other kept watch for reefs and skerries, whales and sundry creatures of the deep. Who knew what lurked in these untraveled waters? Somewhere to the west, perhaps not far at all, was the very rim of the world. A man might be swept over before he knew it, and find himself falling away into the true unknown. Perhaps, after all, they would not sleep.
Food,
grunted Sam, kneeling to retrieve a skin water bottle and an oiled bag of provisions from the box where he'd stowed them. He was used to long days on the water. He and his hand were often out from before dawn until nearly sunset, and Sam was a big man with a big appetite. Salted mutton, flat bread baked hard, an egg or two boiled in the shell. His hens were laying again. Under the circumstances, it was a feast. Sam leaned across to pass the water to Thorvald, and froze suddenly as if turned to stone.
What? Thorvald queried, somewhat alarmed. What is it?
Shh,
hissed Sam, now staring intently at the pine decking between his feet.
Listen.
At first, Thorvald could hear nothing beyond the constant creak of the boat's timbers and the wash of the sea. But wait, perhaps there was something else, a sound like a faint moan or a sigh, and a sort of scrabbling noise, very small, down there under the boards.
Rats?
Thorvald suggested, brows raised. Sam, it appeared, had something other than vermin in mind. His broad, amiable features had turned pale. And now he was levering up the boards that lay loosely over the boat's ribs to allow for easy adjustment of cargo or ballast. One short plank, two, three, and Thorvald, taken aback by the speed and intensity of his friend's reaction, moved forward to peer down into the shadowy hull of the sea dove near the bow. There was a smell. Someone had been sick. And a sound. Not the animals scrabbling now, but a voice, a girl's voice, shaky and weak.
Sam?
Without a word, the two men clambered down into the open hold between the fore and aft decks, where their load of provisions was stored. They scrambled over the crossbeams, moving sacks and bundles, until they had made a narrow way through under the foredeck. Cray was crouched on the ballast stones behind the fish crates, in a hiding place that seemed scarcely big enough for a mouse. They hauled her out, Sam with a modicum of gentleness, Thorvald with hands that shook with fury.
What in the name of all the gods are you doing here? He demanded. How did you get on board? Odin's bones, what will your father say?
Not now, Sam said. She needs water, and we'd better light the lantern, it'll be dark soon. There's a flint down yonder in the small bag, and a bundle of dry tinder. Take care. The fire is just what we don't need.
His tone was level, held carefully so, Thorvald thought, not to further distress the filthy, cheese-pale, snivelling Cray. Distress, huh? He could scarcely believe she'd done something so stupid. Why, by all the gods, why? It defied all common sense. She had put his whole venture at risk, as if she truly wanted him to fail. And what about her own safety? This was no place for a girl. What if she got hurt? What if she got sick? Cray was supposed to be his friend. Friends didn't do things like this. His hands were still shaking as he made fire and lit the small enclosed oil lamp that had been stored just so, like all the rest of Sam's gear. Now Sam was talking softly to Cray, getting her to drink water, wiping her face, making her stretch her cramped limbs. There were tears in her eyes. Thorvald could see the glint of them in the lamplight. Odin save him. What reason could a girl have for dreaming up such a foolish trick? Especially a girl like Cray, with her fondness for trivial pastimes such as fine embroidery and fancy cooking. How could Sam be so placid about it? He should have come alone, Thorvald thought savagely. You couldn't trust anyone, not even the people you thought understood you. Cray was calmer now, sipping water from the bottle, responding to Sam's patience, stretching her arms and legs with a groan and sucking in lungfuls of fresh air. Gods, she looked terrible, her tunic all stained with vomit, her hair in a tangle and her face ghost white in the lantern light. Her eyes had great shadowed circles around them. What? Thorvald began, but Sam silenced him with a gesture.
Food first, questions after,
the fisherman said, rummaging in the bag.
I should think they can hear my belly growling all the way back in Stensaker. Drink it slowly, Cray, just a bit at a time. You'd better try a mouthful of this bread, too. Emptied your stomach pretty well from the looks of it. Come on, just a nibble or two. Feeling any better?
Cray gave a weak nod. She held the bread in her hand, but seemed unable to do more than sit shivering, clutching the water bottle and sniffing from time to time. In silence, Sam cut the bread, sliced meat, shelled eggs, handed Thorvald a portion of each. Hungry as he was, Thorvald found it hard to eat. Finally, he could hold back no longer.
Tell us, Cray. Give us your explanation. Don't you understand how dangerous this is? Don't you realize where we're going?
He could hear the harshness in his own voice, though he was trying to keep it calm. Sam was looking at him with an expression that could not be described as friendly.
What reason could you possibly have for doing something like this? It'll only make everything more difficult. You're going to need me, Cray said, squaring her shoulders and lifting her chin in a way that was all too familiar.
I know it. You'll need me before the end.
Her voice belied her attempt at confidence. It was very small and wobbled. At that moment, Thorvald knew what had gripped him the instant he heard and recognized her voice, down under the decking. It was less fury and frustration than fear. Fear for her, and for what it might cost her to be his friend. It was bad enough to have coerced Sam into coming, into risking himself and his fine boat. But to have Cray in peril, Cray, whose world was all handicrafts and family and blithe sunny days, that was truly terrifying. It was as if his father's hand, the hand that had turned all in the Light Isles to darkness in one terrible season, had somehow crept out to touch his son's voyage, to turn it too to shadow. For a little, Thorvald could think of nothing to say. There was still no moon. The small lantern that Thorvald had hung carefully in the bow cast a circle of pale light, just sufficient to show how tiny they were, men, women, frail vessel, in the immensity of dark ocean that surrounded them.
Not used to this, observed Sam. Keeping her out on open sea at night, I mean. No sign of land, any direction, doesn't feel right, doesn't feel comfortable. Yes, well, I don't suppose it was comfort you expected when you agreed to come, Thorvald snapped, unable to contain the conflict of feelings that was building inside him. It's a trip of high risks, a voyage into the unknown, not some sort of family outing up the coast on a fine morning.
Sam did not respond to this. Indeed, it had not really been meant for him. Taking his time, he finished his meal, wiped his hands on his tunic, tidied away the loaf, the knife, the oiled wrappings. He moved across to adjust the lantern and gazed into the sky a while. The stars were almost imperceptible, even so early in the spring. The nights were washed with the pale afterglow of the sun. Eventually, Sam turned back to the others.
Well, he said quietly, no two ways about it, is there? Sun up, we put about and head straight back home.
No!
It was as if one voice had spoken. Thorvald and Cray had rapped out the response in perfect, vehement unison. Sam blinked.
One good reason why not,
he said, regarding his companions mildly.
One each.
There was an extended pause while Thorvald, scowling, folded his arms and stared out across the heaving ocean, and Cray looked down at the water bottle as if it were an object of intense fascination.
Well?
Queried Sam.
There aren't any, are there? Ah, said Thorvald. That's just where you're wrong. I can see you're concerned about Cray's state of health, not to mention her safety. I have to say, bearing in mind how long we've been traveling and the force of that gale we encountered earlier, that I guess we're a deal closer to our destination than we are to the Light Isles. Isn't our first priority getting Cray to the nearest place of refuge?
Sam did not comment.
Cray?
He asked.
She has no good reason, Thorvald said before she could answer. She shouldn't be here, it's as simple as that.
Cray cleared her throat.
I imagine you made him a promise, she told Sam. A good man keeps his promises.
She did not look at Thorvald.
I did, said Sam, frowning. Trouble is, your father'll kill us if we don't get you back safe. He'll probably kill us even if we do. I really can't understand why you've done this, Cray.
Her voice was firmer now.
I know you're looking for Somerled. I know you're heading for wherever he might have gone. I knew you wouldn't let me come with you, but I needed to come. It's not something I can explain very easily. It's more of a feeling, a deep down feeling. I know I have to be here.
I can't imagine why.
Thorvald's tone was blunt.
You can't sail, you can't fight, you can't help us in any way whatever. All you've done is put yourself in danger and upset your family.
Isn't that what you've done? Asked Cray quietly.
There was another silence, during which Sam unrolled two blankets, put one around Cray's shoulders and settled himself among the fish crates.
All right, he said. My boat, my choice. Only thing is, it's the wind makes the choice for us at times like this. I'm going to sleep for a bit. The two of you can practice tearing each other to shreds all night if you want, as long as you keep your eyes open. Wake me when you want to rest, Thorvald. I'll make a decision at first light.
Thorvald was to remember that night later as a strange lull in the storm of his journey. He recalled his confusion, the guilt and anger and fear warring within him. He remembered how serene Cray had seemed with the lamplight playing on her wan features, how, despite the need to creep to the side of the boat every so often and retch helplessly into the swell, she still regarded him with a calm gravity that annoyed him more than anything, since it told him she was far his superior in self-control. As for conversation, there was little of it. He did not trust himself to speak. She appeared to think further explanations unnecessary. For a while she slept, cheek pillowed on an arm, fair hair fanned out like strands of pale silk. And he watched her, wondering how he could possibly manage to keep her safe and still achieve his quest. His quest. It remained foremost in his mind, though another man might have turned for home without hesitation. Perhaps that was his father's legacy, condemning him always to put his own interests first. Sam's reaction to the crisis had been swift and kind. Thorvald was painfully aware that his own response had been somewhat lacking in compassion. Sam now slept the sleep of a man whose conscience was free from burdens, while Thorvald sat alone with the night and the ocean, pondering the way fate seemed determined to turn his steps astray and make him a misfit. Fate, he thought grimly, never passed up a chance to remind him he was his father's son. Cray shivered, sighing in her sleep. It occurred to Thorvald that there had been a certain bravery in what she had done, wrong-headed though it was. There weren't many girls he knew who could have stayed silent under the deck like that through such a rough passage, nor planned well enough to be there in the first place. None, in fact. If they'd had to have a girl with them, Cray would have been the only possible choice. Absently, he tucked the blanket over her and resumed his solitary watch. He prayed for an easterly wind. There was, indeed, no decision made but that of the gods themselves. In the darkness before dawn, the gentle rocking of the sea dove became a harsher movement, the sea anchor near useless against the insistent pull of the current. The wind came up, whipping a fine spray into every corner of the boat, drenching their clothes, their blankets, their stores. The sea dove's timbers groaned and creaked, her sheets whined in protest. Sam gave directions, Thorvald obeyed them. Cray crouched down, doing her best to keep out of the way. They made a choice, speed over safety, for if Tige's directions were right, this wind would bear them straight to their destination. They hoisted the sail. The gale drove them westward, or perhaps north of westward. The lowering clouds made it too dark to tell. Sam held the steering oar in a death grip, and the others clung like barnacles to whatever they could find. The expanse of sailcloth above them bellied out to within a hair's breadth of tearing asunder. The mast bowed, its strength tested almost to the limit. It came to Thorvald that they had no control at all of the vessel's course. The wind would bear them where it fancied. The best they could hope for was to turn the sea dove into the monstrous waves and keep her afloat until the storm abated. What chance had they of finding a small group of isles about which they knew nothing save that they were somewhere northwest of the Light Isles? Beyond those islands, which might themselves be no more than a crazed man's fevered imaginings, all knew there was nothing but empty water. It was as well the wind sought to snatch the very breath from their mouths, for what was in their minds was better not put into words. Best think only of the task in hand, staying on the boat, gathering themselves for the next impossible surge of water, and the next, and the one after, being ready for the sheeting, freezing rain when it came, somehow forcing the hands to fasten and unfasten the lines, shifting position to balance the sea dove, and in between, praying with clenched teeth and narrowed eyes, straining to see some change in the elements, some small hint of mercy. The boat on which Somerled had made this journey was a tiny curragh, like the ones Tige and his brothers sometimes rowed across to the mainland. Beside the sea dove, such a vessel would be like a duckling to an albatross. The imagination could scarcely encompass how it would be to travel thus. A terrible truth crept into Thorvald's mind. Somerled could not have survived. Following that thought, another, starker still. We're going to die, all three of us. Oh, for a faith like that of Brother Tige, simple and sure, the unshakable belief in your God's eternal mercy. Had not the brothers, too, come this way, guarded by the hand of that selfsame God? Somerled had had no such faith. How could an evil man expect the favor of any deity? If Somerled had completed this journey, it was something else that had given him the will to do it. Hatred, pride, ambition. Yet he had never returned, never come home to confront the friend who had sent him into this nightmare. Sam was maintaining his vice-like grip on the steering oar, the muscles of his arms bulging with effort. His face was white in the faint pre-dawn light. He was shouting something, but Thorvald could not hear the words in the howl of the wind. Cray's hair streamed in the gale like a flag of gold. She clung, tight-knuckled, to a rib. The sail, Sam seemed to be telling him, lower the sail. For the mast was flexing dangerously, the pressure too great, and they must give up any effort to control their path, lest they lose their rigging entirely and render the boat unable to make a course for land, even in calmer weather. Thorvald lurched forward, his sodden boots like lead weights, his fingers numb with cold as he fought to unfasten one rope, then another from the iron hooks that held them. The sea dove shuddered. A mountain of dark water rose before them. Hold on! Someone screamed, and an instant later, the wave crashed over them. Thorvald's nose and mouth, his eyes and ears were full of water. The sea lifted him in a fierce, chill embrace, and he felt pain scythe through his arms as he strained to keep his grip on the rope, clutching as a terrified child clutches its mother in the face of the fearful unknown. Long moments passed. He held his breath until his chest was fit to burst, until the agony could surely be borne no longer, until he knew he was as close to death as he had ever been. And then, with a sound like the groan of a wounded animal, the sea dove righted itself again, and there was blessed air to breathe, and as the light of a new day crept cautiously into the stormy sky, Thorvald dared open his eyes once more. The mast was snapped to a splintery stump, the sail gone. Cray lay sprawled on the deck, gasping and choking, a tangle of rope across her bedraggled form. Between the falling timber and the rush of the water, it was a miracle she had survived. Sam. Where was Sam? The boat rocked violently, her erratic course no more than the ocean's whim. The steering oar swung uncontrolled. Thorvald's heart went cold. Not this, he prayed, though he had never set much store in gods. This is not right. Maybe I want a challenge, but not this, please. Sam! Cray shrieked, leaping to her feet and lurching across the hold towards the stern. The sea dove pitched. Cray fell to her knees and scrambled up again, clambering to the aft deck. Now she was crouching down, the steering oar jerked and shuddered, swinging free not far from her head. Don't just stand there, she yelled over her shoulder. He's out cold and bleeding. Don't you know how to sail this thing? Goaded out of his shock, Thorvald now saw Sam's bulky form slumped on the deck, looking more dead than alive. The bright stream of blood moving down cheek and neck, soaking shirt and tunic, made a note of vibrant color in a dawn storm dark, ocean green, shadow gray. Thorvald edged aft and seized the steering oar, knowing his puny efforts to maintain control were useless against the malign force of the elements, but understanding the need to try. A fight to the death this was, man against nature. He must hang on and hope some higher power, if there were such a thing, would eventually grow tired of toying with them. He'd sought a challenge and he'd got one. The hardest game he'd ever played. Cray was tearing something up. She was wrapping a bandage around Sam's head and pressing on the wound with her hand. Her mouth was set very tight. The rays of dawn light creeping between the heavy clouds showed her even paler than before, as if she too would lapse into unconsciousness at any moment. Now she was trying to move Sam away, just enough to give Thorvald room to maneuver in his desperate efforts to keep the sea dove under some kind of control. Though indeed, without the use of oars or sail, the best he could hope to do was keep her from being swamped. Cray subsided onto the decking with Sam's head in her lap. He was too heavy for her to shift. And now she held one hand over his crudely bandaged injury and hooked her other arm around the nearest timber as the sky rumbled above them and the water surged and retreated, rose and fell, determined to dislodge them. A stain of blood already marked the linen. Cray's shift? That circled Sam's head. Cray looked up at Thorvald where he strained against the shuddering pull of the steering oar. Strands of wet hair were plastered across her face, and her eyes were full of shadows. Sorry, she said. Whether it was for the plight they were in or simply for being in the way, there was no telling. Me too, said Thorvald. The sea dove fled through another lowering day, another chill night in which Sam lay groaning under the two blankets. Thorvald and Cray stared into the darkness, numb with exhaustion, but still doggedly maintaining their watch, one over the injured man, the other on the water, the stars, the movement of the battered craft. They did not talk much. Cray wiped Sam's brow, fed him sips of water, helped him roll from one side to the other. He seemed to be improving just a little. Thorvald did his best to keep some control over their course, though it seemed to him the boat was not responding as it should. He thought the steering oar was damaged, but he did not mention this to Cray. They sighted no land on the second day after losing the mast. The wind died down, the seas became calmer, and the chill crept deep into their bones. They covered Sam with all the warm clothing they could find, for in his weakened state it was important that he not surrender to the cold and give up altogether. The fisherman was sleeping a lot, but when he woke he was talking sense now and trying to make helpful suggestions, which was a good sign. The next night, Thorvald heard Cray muttering from time to time, and wondered if she was losing her mind. That would surely be the last straw.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.